speaker is Dr. Christian Perfect from Newcastle University. And because it's Pi Day, it's the second connection, and because I'm the number 3 area of the number Pi. So please give Christian a round of applause, and looking forward to hearing another one.
So, I'm going to start with a maths test, because that's the most fun thing. So there's pi, or it's written like that, Greek letter pi, or there's pi. Pi is the constant to do with circles. I'm going to ask you a couple of things about what you're going to do. Read that, let's not do that. Okay, so I told you how to do the circles. Then you want to expand on that a little bit. Yeah? Okay, right. This is the level we're going for. These questions are going to be yes or no. Neither of those is going to be the correct answer. Yes? Okay, do you agree with that one? Yeah? It's infinite? In what way is it infinite?
You don't really calculate it, it goes forever and ever.
It goes on forever and ever, yeah. Well, you try and write it down as a decimal, yeah. But, it's not infinite in the sense that it's bigger than any number. Right. Okay. So, that goes on forever. So, there's that. How do you feel about this one? Pi is random.
I don't know if it's the same every time.
It's the same every time. Yeah, but if you ask, you work it out, it's always the same. But I was expecting a couple of you to agree with that, because what about the digits of pi? Are they random?
No.
Okay, no, because it's the same every time, but is there a pattern? Maybe randomness in that sense, where you can't predict what the digits are going to be. How about that? Can you predict what the digits of pi are going to be? If I give you so many, what's the next one? So, you're undecided about that one, or you think yes or no?
I think there is a pattern.
Sorry?
I think there is a pattern.
There's a pattern.
But I haven't, I'm not a scientist. I haven't, you know, I've seen some letters. There must be a pattern, but it must be kind of big.
It must be, yeah, it's a complicated pattern. But I was trying to think of a title for the talk. Those words are popping into my head, it's complicated. Pi is complicated. Okay, so there might be a pattern, but it might be too complicated to work out. It's a question. What is it? It's transcendental. Can anyone wager a yes or no on that? Yes, from your answer. That has no meaning outside of maths. What does the quantum definition mean? Transcendental means it's not the solution to any algebraic equation you might want to write, so we're never going to find a really nice way of finding pi that way. So, but what do we have somewhere? No, I don't have any more points. Pi is the same every time. How do we work out pi? So, that's going to be the next page. Here's one way. Let's get a circle, measure across the diameter, measure around the circumference, and divide them. That will give you pi. Here's a very big circle. Somebody emailed me on Saturday to say that he was taking about 30 children and teachers out to this circle to measure it for Pi Day. Because you need to confirm the value there. It's all well and good, saying what it is. So they went out and measured it. It was around about 1,000 feet across. Sorry, it's America. It's 1,000 feet across. How far how is it around? It was 3,000 something. And they actually got a value of pi of like 3.147, which is really good. Well done, the little kids. Well done, the people 2,000 years ago who made that. This is called Great Circle Earthworks. forgotten during colonization. Somebody made that 2,000 years ago. They made a square a few miles down the road with the same area. That's not possible. Okay, so here's the next way of finding pi. Discovered by Galileo. The period of a pendulum swing doesn't depend on its mass. It does depend on its length and the force of gravity. So if you know those, you can let a pendulum swing and time it. Put numbers according to that formula and get an approximation of pi. It's not a very good way of doing it. It's interesting that the pi comes out there. I suppose it's a circle going on. We're going to have to go to ourselves quite soon. Okay, I need to get to the other side. Here's another way. None of you said pi was random. I certainly were, because I'm going to do some randomness now. One way of calculating pi is just to throw stuff at a square and do some sums with it. Suppose you've got a square and it's like it's 1 unit across and 1 unit up. Then we could look at point square, x squared plus y squared is less than equal to 1. That's the equation of the circle. I'll show you what that means. I'm going to make a lot of points on this square. Ones that satisfy this and be blue. I'm colorblind and I forgot what the other color was. So. Okay. There we go, right, I'm getting that. Points. So we're generating random points and counting the ones that satisfy that. Very slowly, it happens in the mesh. Really slowly. Really slowly. I'm just about getting there. Can you see it? Okay, so this is one of many probabilistic ways of computing pi. The points that satisfy that are forming a quarter of a circle. So I count how many there were, I divide by the total number and multiply by 4 to get. If I multiply by 4, I would get a circle with area 1. I know that the area of that circle is pi. This, again, is not a great way to calculate pi because I have to throw, to get to 10,000, I've got 3.14, I need 2 digits. Around about as good as a class of 30 kids can do it. That's how it works, isn't it? Okay, so that's one way. Now here's where it gets serious. Archimedes, around about, I don't know, same time as those guys over there, roughly, came up with a way of doing it. If you draw a hexagon circle, or rather draw an hexagon, draw a circle that goes around it, draw a hexagon on the inside, hexagon on the outside, you can get two perimeters, and you know that the perimeter of the circle is somewhere between those two. Which gives you a really, really rough guess for pi. You can work this out quite easily because the perimeter of this hexagon is something to do with the square root of 2. You can work that out algebraically. What Archimedes came up with was a way of doubling the number of points and then working out a nice formula for working out the perimeters of the hexagons that you draw between them in terms of the last one. So we don't have to do any measuring, any physical measuring, we have to do four the other numbers. You can carry this on forever. Archimedes did up to 96 points. progress is slow. If you're Americans, you need to get somewhere fast. So, in 1897, a doctor in Iowa decided he worked out the actual value of pi. With a lot of work over 20 years, then he looked in the Bible and found that. The ratio of the diameter circumference is as 5/4. That means pi is 3.2 exactly. He introduced a bill in the state senate, in the state assembly. Got passed, they were very pleased, we found it. Our state can use this number for free, he's going to charge the other states. Fortunately, a mathematician was around the day after that and started educating state senators who also needed to pass the law about just how completely nuts that was. This cartoon from the Chicago Daily Herald or something like that, the Chicago newspaper, mocking some people. Yeah, so that's one of the stupider moments in the calculation of pi. The bill was completely voted down at the Senate. Everybody took the opportunity to say how stupid the people in the assembly were. Okay. So, right. Now, here is an equation for pi. It's not obvious, you get it by angular addition formulae, which you might have done at school. The great thing about this is we know how to work out these two things without measuring stuff with a ruler. We can just use algebra to work out. You get closer and closer to the real values. John Maclean was a mathematician in the 1600s or so. And he came up with this, and people for 300 years since then used this formula or versions of it to get closer and closer. By rewriting it like that. That's better than that.
Sure.
Yeah. No, it's better because now we know we can work this out just using the rules of arithmetic instead of having to measure circles, which is what the arctic function does. And this sum means I can sum up the first few and get an approximation. And if I want to get closer, I can add on a few more terms. But it's bigger and bigger number of n in this format. Okay? So now the local history moment. William Shanks was a mathematician who worked in a school in Chesley Street, just down the road. He had worked under someone very famous, someone I can't remember who. And he made it his life's work to compute really accurate values of pi and a few other constants. Spent 20 years calculating it to 707 places, doing it by hand. Whenever he wasn't teaching children or students, he didn't know where the toilet is, computing pi. This is his life's work, and it's an amazing feat. He did it for history because once you've worked out those places, it's done. We have enough digits of pi. And here we go, he published this in 1873. That's 20 years before the island. So here they are, a load of digits. Spot a mistake. You made an error. Not even right at the end, like down here. Where is it? About 5 should be a 4. With those maths commentaries, you've got, oh, oh, it's a bad mess. All the digits after this one. A guy called D.F. Ferguson from America discovered this. About 70 years later, it took a long time. Because it took 20 years to come up with this. It took 70 years for someone to be crazy enough to try again. So the way D.F. Ferguson did it, he didn't want to waste his life the way Shanks did, he wasted it a different way. He had a mechanical desk calculator, which let him do the computations real quicker. He computed pi, first of all, as far as Shanks' error, to the error, published it. 600 or so digits. Then he went on, we got around 800, we got to 1,000 then, so good one. Since then, we've invented electronic computers, which can do pi, which can do these calculations way quicker. many of the same calculations that people were doing 300 years ago. Some new ones as well. So here's what our record of pi looked like. That, I think, is Archimedes. We had a couple of digits somewhere around there. That's Archimedes. Yeah, somewhere around there. This scale is logarithmic, which means every box here is a factor of 100. You know, each box goes up, you know, 100 times more digits than we did before. Almost all of history only just got over 100 digits. Around about 1950, electronic computers. We now know 13 trillion digits of pi. I mean, in a sense, we always knew how to get them, but now we have them written down. Just for reference, you know. If anybody ever needs it. Okay. So, what do we do from there? We've got 13 trillion. Nobody needs that many. Nobody needs any more. It still takes quite a while to get those digits. It'll take a while to get all of them because they're in front of them. So, what can we do instead? There's a thing called a spigot algorithm. I'm just going to do something like that. For you to understand what this means, you're going to need an image in your head. So I'm going to show you a bear. Where's my mouse? There we go. Right. If we have sound, it's even better. This is what a spigot algorithm does. You crank the handle, it spits out another number. So I don't know what it means. It spits out lines. This is my favourite website. This is what made me love it. You know, people talk about the beauty of maths, made them love it, made them want to be mathematicians. I was 14. Fantastic. Okay. Black on black. Excellent. So that's what I want you to imagine. I've got an algorithm, don't worry about how bad it is, magic. Each step spits out another number. A spigot algorithm spits out digits of pi one at a time. And importantly, you never have to reuse digits you worked out before. The methods we had before, you get 3.1415, da 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 da, and then you add on a really small amount to that, and then you work out what the digits are from there. This one, last digit was 4, okay, fine, get about a heck digit one. The magic thing about that, well, maybe the secret trick is you just remember an infinitely long list of numbers that aren't quite digits. You only need a constant amount of memory. There are algorithms that work with remembering just two numbers. The numbers get big first. You only need to remember two numbers. That's blew my mind. That's incredible. So last year, Friday, I bought a domain name. Recognize what's good about the domain name? It's as many digits as pi as I can ever remember. And now on this website, thanks to the spigot algorithm. Right. Okay. This website implements the spigot algorithm in this digits of pi. So we start at the approximation 22/7, really good. It's all you ever need for pi. If you're ever doing any woodwork at home or anything like that, it's good enough. And so this one goes down, I program in some of the important dates to do with pi. And the good thing about this spigot algorithm is I know that this will go on forever. It might take longer than with a computer, but this will just keep going. So 53 digits is the quantum limit for a measurable pi celebration, meaning there's a shortest possible measurable time, if you were measuring pi days, 3.14, and then maybe 15 hours, what is it, 9 minutes, 22 seconds. If you kept dividing time into small and small bits, that's the closest you can get to any more digits of pi. Okay, so we're going, so we're well beyond practical applications. I mean, 61 digits, that was back in the time of William and Conway. I don't know. We've been wasting our time since then. But, So there's some people discovering more and more 1689. Macklin that came up with that formula. He got 100 digits. He stopped at the round number. Cool. So, where shall I stop?
Shanks,
okay. Well, we'll get to... Shanks, okay. Shanks thought you had that many. It took a while to get to. It's weird about doing that in a couple of seconds. 20 years. Okay, we'll keep going. Ferguson, that's about it, 1940. Right. Shanks thought he had 707, Ferguson did 710 just to put the boot in. Okay, we'll go a little bit further and then. How far do we want to go? Okay. I should have stopped a little bit higher up than that. Which a Feynman physicist said, I know pi up to 762 digits, let me get 999. Six nines in a row, you might draw your nines forever after that. Okay, so that's as far as I want to go with that. Can I? No, I can't. I'll go to the next slide. Nope. Broken my slide. Yeah? Okay, so I'm going to see if I can get past. Right, okay. Right, so that was cool. We can get infinitely many digits of pi without using up all the world's storage. Every one of those can have a 10, 50 trillionth digit. We can just keep going and still have that digit. Fine. This one's even more incredible. Bailey, Bowen, came up with this formula. It's another way of writing pi, like the one we have before. It's an infinite series. But this one's pretty magic. You can extract any digit of pi without working out the previous ones. Even for the formula we had before, I had to scroll down that whole page. I had to work down all the ones for the digits before. Now this, you can say I want a 50 trillionth digit, I can put 50 trillion into here, and it just comes out straight away. Which is incredible. Now let's explain what that means. K here says which digit in hexadecimal. Hexadecimal is base 16, we use base 10, you can work out another version of base 10. If I put k equals 50 trillion into this, I can split this into some bits that always turn out to be whole numbers and forget about them. Some other bits which end up being fractions, and I can take the first digit of that, round it off, and I can work out these fractions. I can tell you a digit. I've got 10 choices. That's going to be wrong that. That is absolutely phenomenal. I don't have to work out all of the digits of pi beforehand. I can give you any, tell me if you've got any digit of pi, I can give you. I now know all of pi. Isn't that incredible? So,
so say you have an equation problem where you're doing a sum, how do you know how many of those digits are correct and won't change when you add on another term?
Okay, an infinite series, actually I'll pick up one. Each of the terms is getting smaller as we go along. So the first one might be 0.3 dots in. The next one might be 0.14 or 0.05 and 0.0 in there. So at some point, the terms you're adding on, they only start so many digits along. So you know all before that, that's never going to change. And then you subsequent terms.
Right, so I've got two questions. The first one is, you said the Macken formula was in, what, 18th century, something like that?
16th.
Okay. So the 17th century, and yet they got to 50 digits, or 60 digits at the time of William the Conqueror. So how did they do that? So that's the first question. The second question is, how do you know that pi is infinite, rather than we just haven't got to the bottom of it yet?
Okay, I'll go backwards. saying it's infinite, meaning it doesn't repeat, is what we mean by that. It's irrational, and there are plenty of proofs of that. None of them would be quick enough to do that. But the way you typically do it is you assume that it is rational, which means you can write it as a fraction of two whole numbers, and then you apply it to something and prove that it breaks. So there are several proofs that pi is irrational. You take my word for it. How did they calculate it before the 17th century? The same way they knew it at the 17th century. They sat down and kind of figured it out. They knew the same kind of maths, they were doing the same thing. They were we go back to what the median is. They're doing it that way. This way. Right. So you start with these two. They're both going to be multiples of root 3, I think. You can easily work out what root 3 is as a decimal. And then you apply the formula back to the next thing, you double the number of points. You double the number of points again, you get these hexagons here, you get closer and closer and closer. So that's how people were doing it. They were writing down numbers. Apply the rule to get the next step, write those down. Apply the rule to get the next step, write those down. That's it. It's clever.
Any more questions?
And I revised all about cooking pies as well. So.
I think that's everything, so I could thank our speaker once again. Alright, well, thank you very much for coming in the end. It was lovely hosting here this evening. I just want to make a quick announcement. Next week, we're going to have a movie night. We're going to screen Gattaca, which is this future dystopian sci-fi movie. You're almost welcome to come. We're going to have a short discussion at the end as well. It's next week, 22nd of March at 6:30 here. So I hope you see as many of you there as possible. Well, thank you again for coming. Help yourself to the food and drinks and the bathroom.